I met this person named Don Rodriguez about more than 13 years ago on the phone the first time. He was interviewing me when I was up north. And it's been great. So, you know, a lot of us have mentors through the years, and I've had a lot of wonderful folks that have guided me and given me suggestions and stuff, but I've never had a mentor partner that we're able to do anything like we've built here at Channel Islands in terms of the scope and the magnitude and all that kind of stuff. So it's been a really wonderful journey. And I would say that for a long time, the thing that we have put together, people used to call the Don and Sean show, because we didn't have a lot of other folks, didn't have a lot of money, didn't have a lot of help, and we've long since left the Don and Sean show, but for a long time it really felt like it was just the two of us. And we've had fantastic help from many of you, but it really was a partnership that we started. And one of the main parts of the partnership was him putting out the fires that I would set. I'd kind of run down the forest, and then the fire would fall, and you'd be like this. And so it was great for me. You might have a few more gray hairs, as do many of you in this room. But I was up in the Los Padres yesterday and today, and I was doing a little drawing for my dad, and I was sitting there, and there was this rock in front of me. And I was staring at the rock for a while, and what really captured me was the layers. It was layers and layers and layers. I started thinking about that. I started thinking about trees, and you start small, and you get bigger. And really, what Don has been for our university, as well as our program, and I think for many of you, is he's really helped lay down the first layers, the key layers, the core layers, the hard, deep roots that will keep that tree, or whatever the metaphor is, going. And I think sometimes we tend to think of growth and expansion as like transformative and completely changing and this and that. I don't think that's how you build things that last for a long time. I think there can be transformation, all that stuff is good, but really it seems to me like we have this heartwood and stuff gets added to it. And it changes shape and it morphs and it evolves, but it always has that core. And that's what I see our programs being and our universities being. And I think Don has really shaped that more than anybody. There's various levels to this, but first and foremost, I think we've worked hard to build a family here. And I mean that in the literal sense, in that we're born in our families, and those are great, but we also have the opportunity in life to pick our families, to build our families. And I think pretty much however you want to slice it, as our program has grown, that's a real key thing. And we hear this from folks that come in from the outside, and they look at us, and they talk to our students, and people really articulate it, that it seems more intimate than a typical program, and we're proud of that. Sometimes it gets to be a problem. Like when people start referring to Don as D-Rod, which he didn't like too much. A little too informal. But, you know, we can talk about sort of the academic layers of that tree, things like service learning, things like focus on community-based research, which are still total hallmarks, I like to think, of our program, and that was all due to Don and his focus, and trying to be transformative, let's do something in a new way. I think the notion of doing innovation, trying things new, not being bound by the way we've historically done them, or the way other institutions have done them, but really try to do what we think is right, and that was really all Don's guidance. Another key aspect of our school and our program is this notion of inclusion and opportunity. And Don really has always been on that really, really strongly. And it's, again, I think benefited many of you in the room, and it definitely benefits all of us. Go on, Indians.
Yay!
So this
Ooh, she's so fancy.
So Don is so inclusive. They've even had students living in their house. That's how inclusive they are. And again, and the last part is not just with the classes and not just with outreach and stuff, but truly building a family of colleagues. And that extends beyond just the typical, you know, being friendly and courteous and stuff. But really, we sometimes are too close, sometimes maybe, right? But we do scholarship together. right? Our whole department as a group. Not because we have to, but because we want to. And I think that's a consequence of the community that Don has really fostered. And it's very easy in academia for people to go their different ways, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, but we've chosen a different path. We've really tried to make this much more of a team thing as opposed to a collection of individuals. And that is, again, more tree roots, more growth, more solid roots that we can all build upon as our university matures, as our program matures, et cetera. And it's interesting because using the tree metaphor, the tree has had some attacks on it, right? Some of which we've fostered by encouraging some weird diseases that we've brought into the tree unintentionally. And sometimes just because of things outside of our control, state budgets, can we hire these people? No, we can't because we don't have enough money and all that kind of stuff. But Don has always been the adult. I've always been the juvenile, as my family will tell you. And so he really acted to when the tree was being attacked to really, you know, solidify up that branch, you know, make that thing more solid, and we've been better for it. And so I know we all have Don stories. So I'll just tell a little teeny one, and then I'd love to open it up and hear some stories, reminiscences that you guys might have. But the one, there's so many I could tell. Don likes to tell me to put out my own snakes, or kill my own snakes, or I have to kill my own snakes. But one small one, just to get us going, was when he came with us to New Orleans. I'm very happy to say all of my colleagues have come with me to New Orleans. All of my tenure track and several of our lecture colleagues have come with us to New Orleans. It's been great. And Don even came one year. Yeah. And so, So the quick story, just to get off and you guys can start telling stuff, was we all sleep in the same, so most of the years we go to New Orleans, we have a house that we rent to try to keep the cost down, also so we live in the community. And so we're not at some hotel somewhere, but we're actually in amongst the folks that are trying to do rebuilding in the case of New Orleans. And so that means we all sleep together, right? And so we're all in the same bunk beds, in the same rooms and whatever. And it was like day two or three or four, something like that, early on in the trip. And the students are saying, hey, you know, Don snores a lot. It's an odd dude, you know, he's old dude. Jeez. It's okay, it just happens all the
time. I stayed up all night.
So Don, so he climbs. So the students are like, Don, oh my God, snoring, I don't snore. Like, yeah, you snore, and all kinds of stuff. So then, the next night, Don's like, I'm going to get these kids back, right? So he decides, he's going to go in, and he's going to record them snoring to get them back. And so I'm up working, you know, late at night, as I typically do. And he's like, I'm going to, and in classic Don fashion,
for the class, I'm going to go record this.
So the room is dark, right? Because everybody's sleeping, and he goes in there, and he's in doing his thing. And we're, oh, man, he's getting like a lot of really good.
They were all guys, by the way.
Oh, that's true, yeah. To be completely clear, these are the male room. This is not the female. And so I'm thinking, oh, he got video, he must have, or audio must have gone to sleep. And about 10 minutes later, he comes walking in. What the hell is Sinko recording?
How do you make this iPhone thing work?
It's, oh, it's like this, and you push this, and he goes, and he goes in the room, and it's like another 10 minutes, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to go to sleep. And they're like,
snake up. He's not sleeping.
I got to snake up on him. And so, and long story short, it went for a long time. Don never got the audio. Snoring, but they all like to talk about their snoring. So, wonderful guy, just maybe not in the bunk next to him. So, I could talk for a long time, but I'd like to open up for any of you guys. That
you also have. Snore a lot.
So, anybody want to share some Dr. Rodriguez stories?
Nobody can see you over there.
No, he's hiding behind the monitor. He's in the confessional.
There's a microphone there, too, if she wants to use the microphone.
Yeah, if you guys want to use a microphone, if you're... Yeah, that, too.
Wow. So
shy. When my family and I came, we went to surprise him, went through the back door of his classroom, and when we got in, he was really surprised, and so he didn't know what to say. So he decided to say, "Oh, these are my grandkids, the new kids on the block."
Yay!
That's a shy granddaughter.
I know. America's Got Talent.
Yeah.
Other stories? We must have some.
I'll go next.
Oh, yes.
I've only known Don for 50 years. 51 years, actually. I met him my sophomore year in high school. I went to Catholic grammar school, so I didn't know him then. But in high school, we played football and basketball and golf together, too. We've been friends forever, and used to go over his house. And his dad was the fire chief. I don't know if you guys know that. San Leandro, up in Northern California, next to Oakland there. And whenever I went to his home, he had his dad in his living room had a pole in there, and it was a brass pole. And a few guys that are young, you're thinking, well, maybe Don't throw a pole dancing. There was no such thing as a pole dancing back then. His dad had taken it out of the firehouse and put it in there. So, and being a smart guy, did he go be a fireman? No, I was the dumbass that ran in the buildings and became an open fireman. He became a professor and a college professor. So we've gone on vacations together, played a lot of golf together, you know, seen our families grow together. It's been great.
We were in a street game together.
Yeah,
he's
trying. I want to run out of everything. Just to throw a little dirt on the subject here.
What?
We had senior, in our senior yearbook, you get voted as, you know, best smile, like best eyes, you know, nicest hair. Anybody guess what?
What was
the best personality?
That's very nice.
You're adorable. Semi-retirement.
Great to know you for 51 years.
And tell us your name for the archives. What's your name?
Kent Costa.
Thank you.
Who's next?
Well, I'm not going to offer any deep, dark secrets.
Disguise your voice.
And that's something the secret room too, so you can verify on the story.
But while I deeply enjoy and cherish all the administrative activities that fill my working life, I have to say that working with Don has facilitated some of the things that have been most enjoyable about my career, which the Yosemite and National Park class and Santa Rosa Island, and just really appreciate the opportunity to work with Don on those. But I do have to second Sean's comments about that he does indeed.
Kelly.
Yay.
Cook.
So, video? I thought you were signaling me. Is this okay?
Oh. Yeah, okay. Video. Yes.
Okay, it's off now.
No, it's fine. It's fine. So Don and I have worked closely together. We've had opportunity to research together, and we've gone on trips. I've become invited in their home for holidays. And one time I'm in chairs meeting with Don, and I get this phone call from Rhonda, and I ignored it because I was in the middle of a chairs meeting. And then she called again, and I ignored it. And then she called again, and I had to answer it. So all the chairs were there, and Don had gotten in a car accident, and so Rhonda, he got hit by a car when he was on his bike. Rhonda was out of town, and he had a concussion, was disoriented, so I needed to go take him to the hospital. So I left, and I went to take him to the hospital, and we're waiting in the waiting room, and the lady's asking questions about Don, and he couldn't answer, and so I was trying to answer, and we couldn't get a hold of Rhonda. And I knew some of the answers, I didn't know some of them, and she said to me, what is your relationship with him? And she said, are you his wife? And I paused, and I was going to say no, but I'm kind of, because I'm like, I don't know what was going to come out of my mouth. But I hesitated long enough, I think I gave the impression that maybe that I was his mistress. So she said, I asked, and I knew really intimate things about him, because Rhonda had just told me on the phone that she had to hang up. And anyway, so he sits back down, we're waiting in the waiting room, and this lady, her husband had come in after, and she was like, oh, that guy looks really bad, because Don had, you know, his face was really bloody. And the lady turns, and she says to him, yeah, and that's not even his wife. So I wanted to turn and, like, defend myself that I was just a family friend, wanting a daughter, and you would do quite well, by the way, to have me. Anyway, and I never had a chance to, like, defend myself because I thought it was inappropriate to, like, care about it anyway. So he was fine. We spent about 6 hours.
Yeah, I mean, I'm, you know, 20-year-old something wife younger than me. I wasn't gonna throw a cool one.
But I just want to say before I turn the mic over to someone else that Don has been a fabulous mentor. I mean, there's been so many times when I've stormed into his office mad about something, and, like, I've written a draft email, and he's like, you can't say that, you can't send that email, you'll get yourself in trouble, and he'll help me shape it. And he's been a really good mentor, helping me with my research, my teaching, and also navigating the culture at Channel Islands. He's been, you know, he's more than a friend, he's family to me.
I know. I need a retake on what you just said.
And you send the email anyway.
Oh, I know. They have tools for that now.
So to echo on what Tracy Lee was saying, I've only been in the department for about a year now, and like 2 years at CI. I'm kind of a baby. But my introduction to Don was not only my job interview, but it was when I got the job and everyone sent the announcement out, he sent me a photo saying, welcome to the department, Mia. We're happy to have you. And it was a photo of him. And he got into a bike accident on him. So it was him, like, his face, just like...
The same accident?
Thanks, Don. I've been looking forward to working with you.
What I was saying is, welcome to the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yeah. And it was a photo of him in a bike accident, which I'm going, are you okay? Like, what's going on? I really loved, enjoyed working with you. I have really good faculty, and I always say that ESRM is an easy-growing group, but most of my faculty are. But being that I'm right down the hall from you, I'm always walking by bugging you, you're always listening to me, and you always encourage me no matter what. You're one of the few people that I work with that always compliment me and encourage me no matter what I'm doing. And I am going to miss working with you. I know you're going to be around for a little while longer, so I'm not dismissing you quite yet. We're not taking you over your office or anything like that, but I really do. I appreciate your candor, and I appreciate everything that you've done for me personally, and I know you've done a lot for the department in general. And it's going to be big shoes to fill on that guy, but I appreciate it, and I really enjoyed it. So I thank you for everything you've done for us and for my growth, so I appreciate it.
What size shoes do you wear?
Okay, I got to tell the Don bodyguard story. So Don and I have worked together for about 13 years, and we spent quite a few of those years when he was the chair of the Institutional Review Board Committee. And so we went up to a training in Sacramento with one of our colleagues, Betty. And we got off the plane, and Don put on his dark sunglasses,
inside. Yes. And he was you know, so many feet behind the two of us, and he was helping us with our luggage. And it was just a crack up because everybody just sort of like kept getting out of the way. And after a while, he kind of stood a little bit taller and was like, and we go to get the car rental. And the guy who was checking the car out to us just kept looking at Dom because he was just standing there like this, you know, watching. And I swear to God, he must have made every single person nervous because he looked like our bodyguard. And he was cracking up the whole time because he goes, I think everybody thinks I'm your guy's bodyguard. And it was really, really, it was quite a trip, and it was a lot of fun. And I think we went out to dinner that night, and we had learned from our colleague that she had dated some really famous golfer, right? This guy, right. Sergio... Yes. And
he is
so
famous.
She was talking about it, and we were eating dinner, and she says, yeah, I went out with this guy, Sergio, and he plays golf, and we're just whatever. And then
he just won the Masters.
She says his last name, and he just like, and he was like, why are you not dating him still? How am I going to get to know him if I want to date him?
I know.
Thank you. Not ditching you back into that.
But we had such a great time together, and truly, it's been such an honor to be able to have you as a colleague. Your presence is definitely going to be felt when you decide to finally cut the cords and retire.
Go fishing.
Part of my experience here, and part of, you know, friends, as long as I have friends in the room as well. And I imagine this to be, you know, had I died at my desk, this might be what my funeral would be. You get to experience that, right? But I mentioned the other day that when people ask me what it's like to have worked at CI, every time we do a recruiting phase and we bring these new folks to campus and are trying to bring new talent to campus, and they ask me, you know, what this campus is like, and I tell them that, you know, for 5 years I commuted to Colorado to make this a reality for myself and my family, but for our lives, and I think it says a lot about the place that someone would be willing to do that. Tell you that it's like no other institution I've ever worked at in terms of the collegiality, how student-centered people are, and how that sense of community makes you better. I am a better teacher, a better scholar for having been with all of you and at this incredible place. Being better than I actually am in terms of that. People say I paid a really big price, right, to do this, commuting for 5 years, but really the price that was paid was the price my family paid. So I want to thank my children, Rachel, Kevin, Jeff, who are all here, for being so supportive. Their dad's big adventure and his return to California to help start this campus. They've sacrificed, you know, those times when it's been great to have a dad around. The many milestones, the games, the proms, the campus events throughout their high school years when I was gone. I did make quite a few games, matches, and things like that. But I think what they missed was those in-between times, right? The word or two before school, the time at the dinner table. Those things can mean a lot, right, when they come at the right time. Parents know that stuff. And they never made me feel guilty for those absences. And I can tell you that your support has meant a world to me, all of you. That's been one of the coolest things in terms of our family unit, and I don't think it's ever really been stronger. It's about quality time together, and I think we have a lot of that. But for the three of you guys, the English have a saying, I love the bones of you. And I do. Thank you, Matt, Nikki, Kayla. I know our family can be challenging at times, and you've all made a family priority. I mean, you're here, and I think that says a lot about our family unit, and the fact that our family kind of gets together weekly is challenging right now. As far as my wife Rhonda goes, this whole career thing has really been a partnership from the time we decided to move 1,000 miles from home to Colorado. She did it without any hesitation, although she cried over the week in Colorado. Getting out of California for the first time, kicking and screaming. But she made her home there, she made our life there, and she did an incredible job. She did it with grace and dignity, a loving partner. She made this career line fit into her life, becoming a teleworker. She actually finessed that and made it happen. Those of you who know her, you know she can finesse just about any situation. But she did that with HP, and then moving back to California once our youngest Jeff had gone off to college. And she cried all the way back. But I think I can honestly say that she's grown to love our life here and our community here as much as our life in Colorado for different reasons. But we're both kind of looking forward to continuing our surf and turf lifestyle by returning in the spring. I can't say enough about what our partnership has meant to me and continues to mean. I think these careers we have in academia and higher ed are all-consuming careers. And if you're fortunate enough to have a partner that is committed to making your dream a reality, as you are, that makes all the difference, right? Thinking about our faculty and ESRM, I've been really fortunate to be surrounded by some of the most collegial, selfless group of faculty at CI. And when you use the word selfless with an academic, those two things don't normally go together. But Dan, new faculty members. Dan Mayer, who's here, Chris Williamson, Linda O'Hara. Thank you for giving so generously of your time and to students and helping. him to build our program. None of us could do half what we do without your efforts, your willingness to always answer the call. I think contributes immensely to what a unique, cohesive program we have that we've built together. Our staff in the SRM for many years, Mary Lawrence.
Right there. Woo!
Mary was my partner in crime for many years, and she incredible knowledge about the university and how to get what you need to get, you know, to have done. Mary is masterful and continues to be a big part of our success in the SRM, even though she's moved on, and she still helps Mia. Thank you, Mia.
Been
the wind beneath my wings. But both of you guys, you have this unfailing commitment to your job and your professional demeanors. I think have been a huge part of our success. You know, the way you treat students with dignity and are focused and put their needs first, very, very cool. Claire Steele, Kiki Ash, our newest tenure track members. You've been a tremendous addition to our family in the ESRM. You are noteworthy scientists, you're exceptional teachers, but more importantly, I think you're tremendous role models, right, for what it means to be a woman, teacher, scholar. You guys are incredibly important in that role. You put students first every time. I'm really impressed with all the things you bring to this. Probably my biggest source of pride and joy and attention was hiring Sean back in 2005. It was a pivotal moment, I think, in the history of the program, and I had a sense that this was going to be kind of a high-risk, high-reward situation. And to be honest, you know, I wouldn't have had it any other way, because high-risk, because with innovation, there's always risk and challenge, right? And moving beyond mundane and predictable is kind of always risky. And I never tried to limit Sean's choices when it came to pushing boundaries, pushing buttons with the program. And the result has been he's taken the program into incredible new directions and positioned our students to be successful in the 21st century as scientists with new technology and new approaches. I've never met another faculty member that's more committed to student success. Someone who has, probably a lot of you don't know this, but he's given up every spring break for the last 11 years to take students to New Orleans and create a model. Like the Energizer Bunny of ESRM. I think the mark of good leadership is to surround yourself with great people and then get the hell out of the way. And that's kind of what I've tried to do at CI in the ESRM program. Now I get to move aside and watch the program take flight, and I trust we put all the right pieces together. It's gonna be exciting to watch this transition into this next decade and how that looks. I couldn't be more excited about the program. When I think about my career here at CI, it's my hope that it hasn't been necessarily defined by my accomplishments, but rather by the doors I've managed to open for other people. That is my biggest accomplishment, both faculty, staff, and for the most part, students. It's been a fun ride. So thank you all for coming and sharing your part of your day.
Not retiring, just going to a little bit lower workload. More golf.
Congratulations,
buddy.
Yeah.
Have fun. Go fall of hunting.
academics.
He's going to be babysitting.
Now can we tell Rhonda's story?
Yeah.
Finish this off.
I am his grandma.